My name is Deb, and I want to welcome you to the Vineyard.
Hi.
If you are visiting us for the first time, we want to welcome you with a special gift. On our back table or at our connection counter outside the back doors, you will find a small gift bag that has some information about the Vineyard and a gift for you. Please help yourself to one if you haven't been given one already. And if at any point during the evening you have questions, please feel free to seek out our welcome team members who greeted you as you came in tonight. Our greeter tonight is Cindy, and she will definitely do her best to help answer any questions you have. Let's take a moment and go over a few announcements. You will notice in your bulletin that there is a giving envelope for any financial gifts you wish to make. Those can be placed in the envelope and put in the basket on the back table. There is also a connection card, which we will get to in a moment. Let me call your attention to the left side of your bulletin. School of Kingdom Ministry kicks off this September 30th. We're excited to kick off our next class of the School of Kingdom Ministry this fall. This nine-month course has been an amazing experience for many in our Vineyard community. This weekly class will begin on Thursday, September 30th at 6 p.m. and will run through May of 2022. There'll be an interest meeting on Sunday, September 12th at the morning service, so please sign up on your connection card. And that also means to mark your calendars for September 12th because it will be a morning service at 10 a.m. right here at the Dean Center. So don't come later in the day. None of the Vineyard people will be here. Next week, oh my heavens, September. Ladies brunch. Our September ladies brunch will be on Saturday, September 18th from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the Ruth home. Please sign up on your connection card. And back to church Sunday. As summer comes to a close, we're getting ready to kick off our regular church programs. Join us on Sunday, September 19th for Back to Church Sunday. We will celebrate the start of Circuit Kids, Revolution Youth, and the new sermon series entitled Romans, The Story of God's Redemptive Gospel. Invite your friends and family that may be looking for a church community to connect with. Tournament of Bands volunteer opportunity. We're looking for volunteers to help serve local marching bands on Saturday, September 25th from 5:30 to 9 p.m. at the Battle of the Bands at Island Park in Blossburg. Please sign up on your connection card if you are interested in serving. Helping will involve things like selling tickets, concession stand food, and directing people where to park. Also, Sherry Poole's sitting out at a table back in the lobby. She has some masks and some heatable burn bags for sale, and all the proceeds for that go to our building fund, the matching fund. So you can check that out. And lastly, connection groups are coming soon. The fall semester of connection groups will be starting the week of September 27th. This year, we will focus on growing together, growing in relationships, growing in faith, and growing to look more like Jesus. Check out the table in the back of the sanctuary and sign up today. At this time, grab your connection card. This card is the way we stay connected as a church body. If you're visiting us tonight, please take a moment and complete the front side, giving us as much information as you're comfortable giving. Regular attenders, you can just give us your name and any updated information. On the back of the card is a place for prayer requests, praise reports, and event signups. For those tech-savvy individuals, you can scan the QR code on the bottom right-hand side of the bulletin and complete the card electronically. We're going to put 60 seconds on the clock while you fill out your connection card. Completed cards can be put in the basket on the back table at the end of the service. And if you're joining us from home tonight, you will find several links in the comments section of the video. The first link is to our digital connection card. Please take a moment to fill that out. There will also be a link to tonight's bulletin and to our giving page for those that wish to give a financial gift to the Vineyard. We appreciate all gifts given to the ministry of the Vineyard. Thank you.
Thanks for bearing with us tonight. We're a little bit pared down. As you probably noticed, there's a lot of people missing, a lot of people sick just in the community. And so we just want to, I'm going to just pray about that as we start, and we're going to open in prayer. We're going to sing some worship and just give this time to the Lord. At the Vineyard, we always start out with a time of worship, and we just want to encourage you to engage. We have kind of a pared down team. We have some new musicians here who are joining us for the first time officially on the stage. Yeah, let's hear it for Esther and Micaiah. And Joseph's a veteran. He's been around a long time. So no, but we're going to just sing some songs and worship, and hopefully you'll know some of them. If you don't, hopefully you can kind of check out the words and join us. But I'll just ask everyone to stand if you're able, if you're with us. I know we have some people joining us from home too, and we just encourage you to engage with us as well. I'm going to pray. Lord, we just give this night to you, Lord. We just lift up our community. We just ask for your healing. We know that you promise that you will heal us, that you can heal every sickness and disease, and COVID is no different than that. And as people are struggling with that and just whatever is afflicting us, Lord, we just ask for your healing. We ask that your healing would come even as we worship tonight. As we lift you up in worship, Lord, we just ask that you'd bring healing to our community and to our hearts. We give this night to you in Jesus' name.
By nature I've fallen, by grace I've been raised. You're calling me, I'm coming home. You're calling me, I'm coming home. Beautifully made, by nature I've fallen, by grace I've been raised. You're calling me, I'm coming home. You're calling me, I'm coming home. We are no longer strangers to your arms. We are no longer strangers to your arms. By your grace you have saved us. We're no longer strangers. We're no longer strangers to your arms. Once exiled by sin, separated by my transgressions, now welcomed in. You're calling me, I'm coming home. You're calling me, I'm coming home. We are no longer strangers to your arms. We are no longer strangers to your arms. By your grace you have saved us. We're no longer strangers. We're no longer strangers to your arms. Father, I'm coming home. Your love is reaching out. I'm running to your arms. Father, I'm coming home. Though I have wandered far, your love is reaching out. I'm running to your arms. I'm running to your arms. I'm coming home. Coming home. Coming home. Coming home. We are no longer strangers to your arms. We are no longer strangers to your arms. By your grace, you have saved us. We're no longer strangers. We're no longer strangers to your arms. When pain wakes me in the dead of the night, you show me mercy with the morning light. Your hope holds me in the gathering dark. The light of your face, the sun of my heart. Your love, your love, it holds me now. Your love, it holds me now. When life is ashes and I'm falling down, you're bringing beauty right up from the ground. When joy has vanished and tears have come, you take my burdens and you leave a song. Your love, it holds me now. Your love, it holds me now. Sing your love. Your love, your love, it holds me now. Your love, your love, it holds me now. A bruised reed you will not break, and a smoldering wick you won't put out. A bruised reed you will not break, and a smoldering wick you won't put out. A bruised reed. A bruised reed you will not break, and a smoldering wick you won't put out. A bruised reed you will not break, and a smoldering wick you won't put out. Your love, your love, it holds me now. Your love, your love. love. Your love. Your love, it holds me now. A bruised reed you will not break, and a smoldering wick you won't put out. A bruised reed you will not break, and a smoldering wick you won't put out.
We're going to do one more song here in time, and this is a new one. It's written by a couple of people who are worship leaders in the Vineyard movement. If you're new to our church, we're part of a organization of churches really around the world. And so a lot of songs have come out of this movement. I think the words to it just really express the heart of what the Vineyard is as a whole. And I really like it. It's called You Have Our Yes. So you can check out the words, join us. It's not too hard to learn. I'm going to give it a shot. And our freedoms, our flags and our kingdoms, all of our idols must bow. Our wars and our weapons, our worldly possessions, all of our idols must bow. You have our yes. Let our lives confess and say, Jesus is Lord. We'll take up the cross, no matter the cost, and say, Jesus is Lord. He is Lord. Our selfish ambition for power and position, all of our idols must bow. Our fearful reactions and constant distractions, all of our idols must bow. You have our yes. Let our lives confess and say, Jesus is Lord. We'll take up the cross, no matter the cost, and say, Jesus is Lord. We say, Jesus is Lord. And our joy is to walk beside Jesus, our Savior, to love those who hate us, embracing our neighbors, to lay down our lives for the poor and the needy. The cross is our call and our only allegiance to Jesus, our Lord. Jesus, our Lord, He is Lord. Our holy commitment in body and spirit to honor You, Jesus, as Lord. Our love and affection, our time and attention, Lord, You deserve it all. Lord, You deserve it all. Lord, You can have it all. That's our prayer. You deserve it all, Lord, and we just give it all to you, Lord. We just want to say yes to what you're doing in our lives and in this community. And, Lord, we give this night to you. I ask that you would speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you may have a seat.
Oh, good evening, everyone. It's good to have you all here. Hi, Justin. I want to first draw your attention to a letter that was emailed to each of us, if we have your email address. It's also in the back table, so please pick one up if you don't remember receiving it. It is about some COVID items that we wanted just to highlight and draw your attention to, that if you have been tested positive for COVID, if you think you might have it, if you don't feel well, please stay home. Please do not put others at risk and yourself possibly at more risk. Communication is the most important thing. If you communicate with Brett or Carolyn, our two... Amen. Jesus is with us, and Jesus knows our needs. And we need to just keep others in mind. So if you can communicate with Brett and with Carolyn about any of that, if you've been to any of our functions and thereafter you're not feeling well and you're just not sure about things, please reach out to Brett and Carolyn. Just again, we want to be looking out for others as well as ourselves. And if you've been in touch or in close contact with somebody who has COVID or may have COVID, you're not sure, again, it's probably in everyone's best interest to stay home, see your doctor, get tested, but follow some recommendations that way. The most important thing is communication, okay, and looking out for everyone else as well as yourself. So there is a letter, again, on the back table. If you don't remember receiving it via email, please pick one up, and you can read that and just be aware of things. The other thing is, while I work in a school, and now masks are required in schools, they're not required at present here, so you don't have to wear a mask. But if you want to wear a mask, feel free to do so. No one's going to judge you for that. Okay, so right now it's your choice. Who knows what the future holds, but you know, if you would like to wear one, if you feel more comfortable with that, feel free to do so. Okay. And again, I just wanted to highlight again that next Sunday, if you show up right now, if you show up for a 6 o'clock service, you'll be seeing some band, I think, play, okay? But you will not be part of the Wellsboro Vineyard church service. Next Sunday, it is in the morning at 10 o'clock. So please make special note of that, and we hope to see you all there. Okay, so mother was driving to school one day, and her youngest child was standing on the seat next to her. Realizing the danger, she said to him, "Sit down, dear. I may have to stop suddenly, and you'll be thrown against the windshield." "No," the little boy said. "Please sit down, dear. I don't want you to get hurt," the mother insisted. "No," came the stubborn reply. Finally, mom threatened a week without desserts. The boy sat down and then defiantly said, "I may be sitting down on the outside, but I'm standing up on the inside." Well, obviously the story is just an illustration, but Jesus said the same thing. If you have a Bible or if you want to look at the screen, we'll be looking at quite a few verses tonight, the first of which is Matthew chapter 5, verses 27 and 28. And Jesus is talking, this is part of the Beatitudes Sermon on the Mount. He says, "You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart." Jesus is saying that anyone who has lustful desires for a woman has already essentially committed adultery. How often do we appear to be living a holy life, living out good actions, but inwardly, we are desiring to do something different. Our actions may look good, but our desires are not pleasing to God and do not align with God's desires. As in our illustration, we may be sitting down on the outside, but inwardly, we are standing up. We often practice behavior management, but Jesus addresses much more than that. Jesus also addresses our desires. So today, we'll look at how our perspectives, our perceptions, our understanding of truth, essentially how our minds influence our desires. And we will learn the importance of having God renew our minds. So please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we can come together and worship you. God, worship you in song, worship you in truth. And God, I pray that as I speak this evening, God, that it would be only your truth that comes out of my mouth. God, that your spirit would use what is spoken and transform lives with that, God. So I pray for this evening, we pray for those that are not here but are perhaps watching, that you would touch their lives in a special way as well, God. So we pray these things in Jesus' name. Okay, so the impact of our desires is seen in the very beginning of creation. So all the way back in Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and that you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Now, we must remember that this was the first sin, the first disobedience to God. Adam and Eve did not have a sinful nature yet. They had an innocent, though not perfect, nature. So we cannot blame the sin on their sinful nature. Before the serpent, Satan, came on the scene, Eve had a right understanding of truth. Eve knew God's truth. Her innocent nature and her right understanding of the truth kept her desires pure. Now, I would think that Eve would have looked at this fruit before this time, but this time, she looked at it differently. This time, she began to desire the fruit. So where did this evil desire come from if she didn't have a sinful nature yet? Well, using his cunning lies, Satan changed Eve's mind about the fruit. Her mindset changed, and this caused her to desire the fruit. Ultimately, she acted on that desire. Eve sinned in her desires and her actions. And then once Adam and Eve ate the fruit, their nature became sinful. And that sinful nature got passed down from generation to generation to the rest of us. While we inherited a sinful nature, when we trust in Jesus, we become a new creation. Amen. I believe the Bible teaches that our old self is removed, literally killed, and replaced with a new creation when we ask Jesus to take over our lives. We are freed from being a slave to sin and made new thanks to Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. Paul tells us this numerous times in his New Testament letters. In Romans chapter 6, verses 5 to 7, Paul is writing to the Romans and he says, For we have been united with him, that is Jesus, in a death like his. We will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. And another verse that this is one of my favorite verses in the Bible is 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. When it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here, exclamation point. And not only in Paul's letters, but Jesus himself talked about this. When he was speaking with Nicodemus in John chapter 3, Jesus is talking to Nicodemus and he says, very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they're born again. How can someone be born when they are old? Nicodemus asked. Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. Jesus has not cleaned up our old selves, our old sinful selves. He has made us new. We are reborn. We are a new creation thanks to what Jesus did. You can start your life as a new creation today by choosing to trust in and follow Jesus. Here at the Vineyard, we share a simple process to do that. You simply tell God, sorry, thank you, please. Sorry, I'm sorry, God, for the things that I have done and my attitudes and thoughts that have been unloving to you and to others and harmful to others and myself. Thank you, Jesus, for stepping in and paying the price for my sins. You took the penalty, Jesus, that I deserve. Please, please, God, would you please take over the leadership of my life? From this day forward, I want to follow where you lead me. So if you wholeheartedly believe and trust in Jesus and tell God, sorry, thank you, please, you've become a new creation. Now, in nature, when I think of a new creation, I think of a caterpillar becoming a butterfly. Okay, it's kind of an obvious one. From an external view, you look at the two, and the difference is totally obvious. They're totally different critters. But even more than that, they desire totally different things, such as different food. A butterfly could still choose to think like a caterpillar and maybe want to eat leaves instead of nectar, but it would not be living the life that is designed for a butterfly to live. It would not be living like a butterfly. Well, we should want to live the absolute best life that we can, which is the life that God has designed us to live. Now, while we are a new creation, when we trust in Jesus, our minds are still our minds. Our mindsets have been shaped by experiences and emotions throughout our lives. We often don't even realize or remember the experiences that have shaped our minds. The Bible tells us that our minds must be continuously renewed by the Holy Spirit so that they can align with God's truth and so that we can live out life as a new creation, so that we can desire what God wants for us and not merely practice behavior management. Having a renewed mind means having God reshape our thoughts and our mindsets through the Holy Spirit and God's Word, the Bible, which will also reshape our desires and actions. Okay, I used to own a 1997 Geo Tracker. In a word, the thing was a beater. I paid just over $600 for it, so you can't expect much for that. But until I owned that car, I think maybe in my life I saw one or two geotrackers on the road. After I owned that car, all I saw were geotrackers on the road. It seemed like, anyway. Well, before I started preparing this message, I could think of several verses that applied to our minds and the importance of renewing our minds. But as I looked into it more, there are many, many verses that stress the importance of renewing our mind. Like, there were many geotrackers when I started looking for them. So tonight, we're going to look at just a few of those verses. In John chapter 16, verses 12 and 13, Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he says, "I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come." If you are a follower of Jesus, a new creation, because you trust in what Jesus has done, you have the Holy Spirit that Jesus said will guide you, that is, lead you and point the way into the fullness of truth. Now, I don't know if any of you have ever been on a guided tour. Could be anything from maybe the process of making maple syrup at a sugar shack to maybe the battlefields in Gettysburg. But you know that a tour guide does not dump all of the information on you at once, okay? It's a process of sharing the information. A good guide picks up on the cues to determine what they should share when and what you're especially interested in. And they often highlight some of those areas as well. They get to know you a little bit. Well, the Holy Spirit is the absolute best guide we could ever have, because he knows us better than we know ourselves. He knows areas of our lives that we need to grow and mature in. He knows mindsets that we have that are not based on truth. And he will guide us in replacing those lies with truth. The Holy Spirit will guide us in the lifelong process of renewing our minds. Romans 8, verses 5 and 6. Those who live according to the flesh have their mindset on what the flesh desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mindset on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. Setting on our minds on what the Spirit desires means processing all of life through truth, through the lens of the Bible, through what the Spirit desires. Now, something that I recently read and I found to be interesting is that there's no such thing as neutral thinking. I did recently listen to a radio interview between two male hosts and a husband and wife, and the three males did convince the wife that there are times that the husband has absolutely nothing in his mind, like total blank mind, not thinking about anything. I have never experienced that, so I can't comment on that, but some of you guys might know what that's like. I don't know. It was on the radio, that's all I'll say. But when we are thinking, we are aiming at something based on our mindset and our perspectives. We need to ask ourselves honestly, what are my thoughts aimed at? Pleasing myself? Or pleasing God? Going my own way, or looking to be led by the Spirit and God's word? Yet another verse. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Now, in the Greek, and I don't speak Greek, so I had to look this up. In the Greek, to conform to something means follow the pattern of, or actually like to shape or mold oneself after something. The world tries to get us to follow its pattern of doing things, its pattern of living. However, the word transform literally means metamorphosis or a total change. Being transformed breaks us out of the mold of the world. As we said, our transformation or our metamorphosis is a lifelong process and progress toward godliness, toward having our minds renewed, having our thinking changed. And while it is a work of God in us, we are not passive in the process. We are responsible to discipline ourselves for the purpose of godliness. The end result is that we will be able to test and approve, or in other words, to understand and agree with what God wants of us, and we will desire to put that into practice. As I said before, we are not passive in the process of renewing our minds. So how do we actually cooperate with God to make this happen? How do we actually do this? How are our minds renewed in practical, everyday terms? Well, our minds are renewed as we read the Bible. Now, we all know that there is reading the Bible, perhaps a 5-minute devotional in the morning, and there is reading the Bible. Kind of like there is a McDonald's Happy Meal dinner, and there is a steak and salad and potatoes dinner. The Happy Meal might hold you over, but you won't get all the nourishment that you need to sustain you in a long-term basis. The real nutrition is in the steak and salad and potatoes meal. Well, reading the Bible is kind of like that. To renew our minds, we need to really read and study the Bible. That means we need to keep reading the Bible over and over again, asking the Holy Spirit to guide us. Now, I won't ask for any answers, but just kind of, I'm going to ask, don't shout out, how many hours do you think it takes to read the Bible? Everyone kind of have a number, the whole Bible, number in your head? 72 hours. Okay, some eyebrows went up. 72 hours. I had a friend that in his line of work could put earbuds in. He would listen to the Bible every 2 weeks at work because his work week was 80 hours long. So if you have CDs or if you have an app or anything like that, 72 hours. It doesn't seem that daunting of a task when you hear it put that way, okay? We need to study passages that the Holy Spirit draws to our attention. We need to meditate on and think deeply about truths in the Bible and how they apply to our lives. We need to memorize verses so that we can evaluate situations and decisions through the lens and filter of God's Word. Now, some may not see the need to memorize the Bible. After all, it's on your phone, it's at your fingertips. Right? Well, let me ask, how far from a fire hydrant do you need to park? How far from a crosswalk at an intersection do you need to park? We can look those up on the internet, as I did because I didn't know off the top of my head. You can look those up on the internet, but when I'm driving my car and I need a parking spot, I need to know that information now. I can't be looking things up. It has to be in here. And it's the same. We're similar with memorizing the Bible. Through life, we're often in situations and circumstances where we need to make quick decisions and we need to act immediately on things. We don't have time to look things up in our Bible. We have to know what the Bible says about it. And the Bible tells us this. because in Psalm 119, verse 11, the psalmist says, I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. We need to know what the Bible says so it can filter our thoughts and inform our decisions in the now, not when we look it up, in the now. That's a reason to memorize the verses from the Bible. Now, if you have trouble memorizing, and I would say as people get older, they tend to have a little bit more problem with memorizing things than when they were younger. So younger people memorize now, so it's in there. But I would suggest, while it's sometimes very hard to remember a verse from the Bible, sometimes it seems harder to forget a song. So if you put Bible verses to music, chances are they'll be in there. I'll say indefinitely, but they will be in there. So no one should say, well, I can't memorize anything. If you can sing a song that you remember, you can memorize scripture, memorize the Bible as well. So in a word, we need to be saturating our minds with God's word. Now, saturating is a pretty intense word. It's not dipping something in a bucket and pulling it out real quick. It's like submerging, kind of unraveling things, letting it get soaked, and it probably weighs like five times the amount when you put it in the bucket. We need to saturate our minds with the Bible, and that seems intense, but it's amazing how many things in life we are willing to saturate our minds with. Now, I happen to enjoy sports. Football season is approaching. I usually go to a friend's house and watch football, typically Sunday afternoons. The average football game, NFL football game broadcast, is over 3 hours long, 3 hours and 12 minutes, okay? And this number is going to be, you could probably say any number and have it be true, but teens and 20-somethings spend an average of 10 to 15 hours a day on their screens, on their phones, on their iPads, on their laptops, all of that. Now, some of that might be school, and some of that might even be work, but probably not 10 to 15 hours a day. And those that are outside of their teens and 20s, you know how much time you spend on your phone or on your iPad or whatever. So it is amazing what we're willing to saturate our minds with, what we choose to, and what takes all the time in our lives. I believe I can capture it with the word priorities. Okay? We always tend to find time to do the things that are really important to us. So how important is renewing your mind? As we read God's word, we need to be attentive to the Holy Spirit as we ask Him to reveal to us where our minds need to be transformed and renewed. Let me share how this can affect our daily lives. As I said, unfortunately, many of our mindsets have been shaped by our life experiences and not by God's truth. Maybe you live with an anxious mindset. Will you allow the Holy Spirit to impress truth on you? And will you follow His guidance? Again, we can look in the Bible at Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. So if you're anxious about things, this is what the Bible says. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So there's one daily thing that people struggle with. Guess what? The Bible talks about that. Maybe you live with a prideful mindset. Guess what? It's in there. Galatians chapter 6, verses 3 and 4. If anyone thinks they are something when they are not, they deceive themselves. Each one should test their own actions, then they can take pride in themselves alone without comparing themselves to someone else. Well, perhaps you have a mind that is prone to envy, or maybe fear. The Bible speaks to virtually every area of our lives. How should we think about our trials or our success? How should we think about our relationships, even when we've been disappointed or wronged? How should we think about money? The Bible speaks to these and many, many more life issues. So God doesn't want just behavior management. As Christ followers, God wants the Holy Spirit to guide us through His Word, the Bible, to renew our minds. God wants our desires to align with His. We need God to renew our minds, to change our mindset and our understanding to match His, so we can live the life that God desires us and designed for us to live. The worship team, come on up. And I will just say that if anyone is here tonight that chose or wants to choose or just wants to get some more information about becoming a new creation, which is available because of what Jesus accomplished for us, please talk to me, talk to people on the ministry team. Or if you're watching at home, please email the church. We'd love to talk to you more about living life as a new creation, as a follower of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for you. We thank you that when we wholeheartedly trust in you for everything, God, you do not disappoint, God. And you make us a new creation. God, help us to be diligent in being disciplined in renewing our minds and allowing the Holy Spirit to use your truth, your word, to renew our minds to match your desires for us, God. So God, I thank you for this time that we could spend in your word, and I pray that it will have been meaningful to people, God. And I pray this in Jesus' name.
Sing one more song here, and I had been thinking about this song even before Barb told me what she was preaching about, and she was talking about songs helping you memorize scripture, and this has been one of those for me. It's a really old one. It's actually from the kind of the foundations of the Vineyard movement in the 90s, and it's always stuck with me. I'll paraphrase. But it's in Romans 1 and 2. You were later in Romans, I think. But in Romans 1 and 2, Paul's talking about judgment and, like, all the problems people are having, basically. And I think we as Christians can, like, look at the problems out there and point to the problems instead of pointing people to Jesus. So in chapter 2 of Romans, he says, you're so focused on judgment, but don't you know that it's the kindness of God that leads to repentance? And that's the chorus of the song. And we at the Vineyard, we try to choose songs that are out of scripture, so you might not even realize some of the scripture you already know from songs that we sing. But this is one of those ones that stuck with me. And as Barb said, I mean, before we can be transformed, we need to come to a relationship with Jesus, and that comes through the sorry, thank you, please. And if you haven't experienced that kindness of God and you haven't started a relationship with Him, I would just encourage you to do that and pray with someone here tonight. So as we continue to worship, we do have some ministry team people available. We'll have officially ministry time coming up, but just as we sing, if you feel like praying for someone or you feel like you need prayer, just encourage you to respond to that. So this is an old one, and if you know it, help me out. And if not, Heard it. Yeah, stand if you can, thanks.
Oh, my Lord, you are so kind. Oh, my Lord, you are so kind. Morning to morning, day to day, you reveal your righteous ways. It's your kindness that leads to repentance. It's your blood that brings forgiveness. It's your mercy that leads me here to your throne of grace. In your kindness I find repentance. In your blood I find forgiveness. In your mercy I find myself at your throne of grace.
Sing that again.
Oh, my Lord, you are so kind. Oh, my Lord, you are so kind. Morning to morning, day to day, you reveal your righteous ways. It's your kindness that leads to repentance. It's your blood that brings forgiveness. It's your mercy that leads me here to your throne of grace. In your kindness I find repentance. In your blood I find forgiveness. In your mercy I find myself at your throne of grace. It's your kindness that leads to repentance. It's your blood that brings forgiveness. It's your mercy that leads me here to your throne of grace. In your kindness I find repentance. In your blood I find forgiveness. In your mercy I find myself your throne of grace.
Mic on? Okay. Each service, the end of each service, we like to offer ministry time. So if ministry team members would like to make your way to the sides, that would be appreciated. If any of you have anything you want prayer for tonight, either for yourself or for a loved one or someone else, whether it be physical healing, emotional healing, spiritual healing, whatever needs you may have, that's what the ministry team is here for, to take your requests to God, to kind of act on your behalf that way. So, Holy Spirit, we ask you to come in your power and your presence tonight. God, I pray that anything that might be weighing down the people here, they would be willing to bring to you and lay at your feet and have you deal with, God. I pray that you would just be moving in the hearts and lives of each person listening right now, God. Holy Spirit, we need your power and your presence. So again, if any of you want prayer, just step to one of our ministry team, or if any of you feel led to pray for someone, just go ahead and do that.
Pocket, oh Jesus, want you to spend me any way that you want, and I want to surrender to the plans of my Savior. Many will find to spend me any way that you want, and I want to surrender to the plans of my Savior. Many will find you and be saved from their fall. Part to play, not my will, not my way. Help me to find my heart to play, and I wanna be. Oh Jesus, want you to spend me any
Thank you all for coming out tonight. Remind you that we will have a morning service next week at 10 o'clock. And we will continue to have people available to pray after the service if you need it. So take advantage of that. But if not, have a great week. And we'll see you next week.